talking about fungal foam and its use as a packing material, replacing polyester. All right, so before we get started on the details of any of these materials, I just wanted to go through a quick outline of the information that we'll be presenting this talk. We're going to start with the background, which will cover the applications of fungal foam in the future, as well as essentially the current applications of polystyrene, which is the material that it is seeking to replace. In terms of polystyrene, we're going to talk about the properties that make it desirable, how it's synthesized in industry, its macro and microstructure, and its current performance. We'll also be looking at a couple of the problems that polystyrene has, particularly environmentally, which is why fungal foam makes such a great replacement for it. Moving on to fungal foam in itself, we'll be looking at properties that make it a desirable packing material, its synthesis in the industry, the micro and macro structure of that, and its performance as a packing material. Finally, we'll be looking at its future in industry, as well as any problems that it currently has in industry.
So I'll be talking about polystyrene to kick this off. Expanded polystyrene or EPS is used in many packaging applications. You've probably seen it used in these packing cans form or packing chips you see on the left. And also on the right, we have a shock absorber that you see with many larger packing sets. Maybe for a speaker set or computer set, it helps absorb the shock if the cardboard box might shift during in the truck or in the plane during delivery. Next slide. So moving on, what are some of the applications for fungal foam? Fungal foam can be thought of as a substitute to polystyrene. It fulfills many of the same functions. So moving on to the next slide, you see that fungal foam can also be used in packaging. Here we have the same shock absorber you saw earlier used on a Dell computer, except this time it's made out of fungal foam. Here you have maple syrup wrapped in this sort of set in the same shock absorber as well. Additionally, styrofoam has been used in insulation and also in buoys and rafts. Fungal foam fulfills the same purpose, although it has not been used right now commercially in acoustics and insulation. The company on their website does advertise that they are interested in these types of projects. And for buoys and rafts, they are currently doing research on making the fungal foam more resistant to seawater, but it does float. The main obstacle right now is that it dissolves in seawater because it is biodegradable over a course of weeks. Moving on, so what are some of the background, what are some of the polystyrene properties? This is related to many of these applications. So if you're using polystyrene for packaging insulation, let's talk about packaging. If you use it in packaging, you want it to be low cost. So polystyrene does have a very low cost of production. It's also low density, which means it's very lightweight. Of course, you don't want to add a lot of additional weight to your package in just the packaging material. It's also stiff, which makes it very good at absorbing the shock in those shock absorbers that you saw earlier. And because it's used in insulation and also it's used in coffee cups as well, polystyrene has a low thermal conductivity, which makes it ideal for those applications as well. So, talking about polystyrene synthesis, polystyrene itself is a polymer, which means it is constructed out of a chain of many monomers. The styrene monomer is shown here. In constructing polystyrene, you need to use a catalyst because the natural reaction occurs at a very slow rate. So how this happens is you add this benzoxyl radical to a solution of styrene monomer, and with time, the monomers will link. Essentially, this bond that you see right here is the one that's going to break. And that bond is going to bond with another styrene to form multiple chains. Now that's essentially the small scale reaction. You can imagine in industry, next slide, that you will need to do this on a larger scale. So you'll take the raw materials, essentially allow the reaction to occur in a silo, and then once you have these polystyrene pellets, what they'll do is they'll pour them into a molding block with pressure and heat. They'll turn the pellets into a large block of polystyrene and then cut the polystyrene into specific shapes depending on what the customer has ordered. Polystyrene, like you mentioned, is used for packaging, so you can imagine cutting it into the shock absorbers or even little legs for furniture as well, whatever shape the customer needs.
So next we're going to talk about the structure of polystyrene. As Tito mentioned, it is a polymer, and you can see its monomer here, and then this is the repeating unit. It's a thermoplastic vinyl polymer, and so it's only made of carbon and hydrogen atoms, and you can see the chemical formula and chemical structure here. This is an atomic view of the monomer. And then if you go to the next slide, we see that it has an atactic structure, which is completely random, but if there's a different way to produce it that gives it a syndiotactic structure, so it has a predictable pattern. So this is the microstructure of the material. The first picture on the far left is actually a macrostructure, and you see these little beads that are part of the expanded polystyrene. The next picture is a more zoomed in picture of the beads, and you start to see this matrix forming. And then when we zoom in more, you see this is a microstructure. This first picture is a zoom in view of the bead itself, and as you can see, there's lots of empty space, which helps polystyrene be more lightweight. This picture on the far right is the view of the microstructure, like where the beads are touching each other. Okay, so polystyrene, and as used in packing materials, is typically used to cushion any item that it's holding. So it's important that it can protect against shock and vibration, especially under compressive loads, and it's also useful for it to be resistant to temperature changes. This first graph here is a stress strain curve for polystyrene under compression. The first region up until point A is the linear region, and the second region, it diverges from that. And then once you pass point B, then the material has undergone irreversible deformation. This second graph here is a cushion curve, which is commonly used to evaluate packing materials on their ability to provide cushioning for whatever they're trying to protect. And this shows polystyrene at multiple temperatures and how it performs there. So there are a few problems with polystyrene as it is right now. First, it's made from oil, which has a lot of high energy content that's not being utilized very well in styrofoam. It's also got problems with biodegradability and its impact on the environment. Although it is recyclable, it's most often not recycled because there's not really programs in place for typical consumers to recycle. It can be burnt to recover energy, but this also is not commonly done. So it usually will end up in a landfill where it will never degrade. And it can even end up in the ocean where it will break down into small particles, and it can be eaten by other animals, which can provide a danger to them and to us if we also eat them, because the materials in polystyrene are carcinogenic.
All right, now that we've taken a look at polystyrene, we're gonna move on to fungal foam. Before we get into the details of its structure and synthesis and so on, we're going to take a look at exactly what it's made of. Here we see two pictures that are the two major components of fungal foam. On the left is a picture of what's called mycelium. Mycelium is basically the roots of fungi, such as mushrooms. This is used as an organic adhesive to combine other organic parts which are digested by the mushroom or other fungi when put under the right conditions. The agricultural waste that is used in fungal foam tends to be locally sourced by the companies that create it, and is also essentially waste that would not have otherwise been able to be used or consumed in any form. For example, rice husks or oat hulls. So looking at the synthesis in industry, so one major downside to fungal foam as opposed to styrofoam is that it does have a bit of a time delay between the start and the end of synthesis, so there is a bit of an overhead in that regard. But otherwise, it's a fairly simple process. It begins with just combining the mycelium with whatever agricultural waste has been purchased by the company. This can be as simple as tossing everything into a giant bin and mixing it up a little bit. So the major time delay comes in the second step, which is basically allowing the mycelium to grow through the waste. This is typically about 5 days long, and in the process, essentially the mycelium digests the organic agricultural waste and essentially spiderwebs itself through the entire mixture. After this is complete, the company will loosen the particles and then place them into a shaping tool. The shaping tool can be any shape that is necessary for the packing material to take. So for example, the shock absorbers that we saw earlier could definitely be possible. The last step is to completely dry the material. This stops the mycelium from growing any further and basically preserves it in the state that it was in at the time of the drying. So fungal foam does have a lot of the same properties as styrofoam that make it really desirable as a packing material. It is very lightweight and strong. It is also naturally waterproof and fireproof, which is something that styrofoam cannot say. And it actually stiffens when exposed to heat rather than weakening. So under potential extreme conditions, it would actually perform much better than styrofoam. One huge bonus is also that it's made completely out of organics. Since it's not petroleum-based, it's a very low-energy material, and that is awesome.
Coming to the fungal foam's microstructures, it is basically made of agricultural waste, such as the husk of rice, wheat, as well as the lignins. And then these materials perform as a matrix material since of decomposes, and then the mycelium that we that is put into the process of the synthesis perform as a string reinforcement inside of decomposes. And then since the source of the mycelium spreads out 360 degrees inside of the 3D structures of the material, it's going to provide a 300 degrees support within these 3D matrices, which result in really strong resistance towards shocks, impressions, compressive forces, and even the stretching forces. Also, there is an image from the microscopes of the myceliums, and then these string lines are inside of the materials they're providing as a string supports inside of it. So coming to the fungal foam performances, it is most of the data are privately owned, so there's not many really detailed data we can use, unfortunately, although we have a nice picture from the company that they're testing on it. For really bad for us, they're not revealing the data. So in generally, the fungal foam is a really good impact absorbers, such as the polystyrene lens. So in that performance, we can replace the polystyrene as a packing materials. Also, it is really flame retardant. The polystyrene starts to melt slightly above the 100 degrees of Celsius, but unlike these polystyrene, it is way much resistance towards the heat, even if it withstands more above the 100 degrees of Celsius. Also, it is really biodegradable with the moistures and the other enzymes nearby in the earth. It starts to decompose and then it's fully decomposed within a few weeks.
Okay, so for fungal foam, it's currently being sold to Fortune 500 companies, and it's mainly being produced by one company that's Incubative Design. And they're trying to expand and work on their development and manufacturing and create more plants. However, there are some major problems that are preventing fungal foam from being more widely used right now. And mostly that is that fungal foam takes a very long time to be produced. It takes 5 days for a single product to be created. And the cost is also high compared to polystyrene, which would require more research to try to bring that cost down so that it can be a true replacement. However, it can be used and created anywhere as they can send a starter kit to anyone around the world, and you can create your own fungal foam, and then you can also compost it anywhere, and it's completely biodegradable, which is much better than polystyrene.
So in conclusion, fungal foam is a green replacement for the currently used polystyrene, which is extensively used for the packing materials and insulators. With the desirable properties of the polystyrene, the fungal foam has one really good green characteristics, which is completely degradable. However, it is still takes longer time to produce and synthesize, and this remains a technical challenge that needs to be solved in order to make the fungal foam more available. To sum up, fungal foam is one of material sciences changing our worlds, and fungal foam is one of the materials that is going to change our life in the future. Thank you for listening.